So welcome everybody. I don't think that is actually the ending to Love Supreme. It's a slightly abrupt ending. It's not how I remembered it, but in the interests of time, we cut him short. But yeah, Viveka's just said just as Coltrane was about to enter the next layer of the stratosphere. So yeah, welcome again. Yeah, it's really nice. I feel like I'm gradually getting to know you, getting to know you all, and your various living contexts, which looks like kitchens and bedrooms and loft apartments and outside verandas with dramatic mountain views, and yeah, real range of context, wooden huts and things. So yeah, it's really nice to see you all. Welcome back. So yeah, more precious opportunity to practice together for this final session of the day. So just as an outline, I'm going to lead us in a short arriving practice for 5 minutes, and then Viveka's going to host the harvesting session to hear back comments and such from the input earlier today. And then this evening, sorry, for the third session today, we're going to have our first longer kind of period of ritual with verses. So requests to Guru Padmasambhava. So we'll be invoking the energies of Padmasambhava later. And just on that, we're looking for some volunteers. So how we'll do the verses is in call and response. But because of the time differences, the response can get very audibly complicated if we all unmute. So how we'll do it is Singhashri will say a line, and then we're looking for one person for each of the we've already got one person volunteer, but we're looking for one person for three of the verses to be the voice of the retreat. So if that's something you might like to do, it just involves listening to Singhashri and then being the one other person in the group that's unmuted to repeat back the words. So it's not a technically challenging role. So yeah, if you'd like to do that, if you could privately message Singhashri. And we're also looking for someone to give a reading in the verses as well. So if you'd like to do that, then do message Singhashri, and I'm sure she'll get back to you. So yeah. So yeah, some opportunities to volunteer. Good. So let's do some arriving practice. And both of these are, well, arriving practice is really an invitation to dial up the curiosity. So let's see what happens. And there's one way we can dial up the curiosity, and that is to help the body feel resourced and to help the system feel a little bit safer. Yeah. So when the system feels regulated, we're all online, it's much more accessible to be curious, engaged, empathetic, aware, present, and so on. So I'm just going to share two little techniques. And an invitation for you is to dial up the curiosity and just sense how it is in your body as you do this. One is, this is probably the most common, what I'd call spontaneous self-regulation thing. And this is something that it seems to be almost in our genes that we just do it naturally anyway, when the system feels like it needs a bit of reassuring. It's very, very simple. But it's just a very simple placing the hands on the top of the legs and then just stroking them. Yeah. So again, finding your own pace and pressure. How is it for you to just bring awareness to the felt sense in your hands and in the top of your legs for there to be contact like this? Great. And then from there, we're going to do a little self-regulation technique called the basic exercise. So this is my favorite of all the self-regulation techniques I've come across. Basically with this, we have two hands, and we place them at the back of the head at the occiput. Obviously, you know, if you have physical limitations to this, just doing what feels comfortable. So this is a technique that many people find effective in sometimes the survival physiology, even if it's on only slightly of fight, flight and freeze, gets stuck in that a bit. So this is a technique that can help the ventral vagus, the system that supports social engagement and regulation of our systems, come back a bit online. So it's very, very simple. The important thing here is to not move your head. So see if you can just look directly forward. And then all you have to do is just move your eyes to the left as if they're looking towards or at your left elbow, but not moving the head, and sense. And then coming back, looking forward, allowing your system to just kind of recenter again. So we're not forcing anything here. If you start to feel dizzy or something, just pull back a bit. And then we just do the same on the other side. We're keeping the head facing as it is and just moving the eyes to look to the right elbow. And then when you're ready, coming back to center. So I've done a little YouTube video on the basic exercise. So I'm just going to post that if any of you want to find out a little bit more about that exercise. Good. So maybe some of you have your curiosity dialed up a little bit. A little shift in physiology there. And I'll pass over to Viveka.
Balajit. All right, so just reminding us that in the harvest, just a chance to get a sense of how the teachings are resonating. How they're being metabolized through you, what's coming up. If you want to add any comments in chat, you're welcome. And then there's a Padlet, which the link is in chat too. And there are little comments in here already. All right, so I'm going to review a little bit about what we covered. And it was a bit spontaneous. So I'm going to tell you what I recollect. And we'll see if that sounds familiar. Okay, so we started with this James Baldwin quote, which I will put in the chat again. And it's also in the Padlet. And that was really the crux of what we explored, that not everything that is faced can be changed, but nothing can be changed until it's faced. Nothing can be changed until it's faced. And just appreciating that James Baldwin as a courageous, creative civil rights elder, queer, Black, apparently fearless in how truthful James Baldwin was in communication. That James Baldwin was concerned about inner freedom for himself, for race relations, for our planet. And then also, out like that out into the world. And we also heard a little bit of Marvin Gaye, what's going on? What's going on? Just to actually, again, like bring that question about what's going on and actually listening to how we're being moved by our experience in the world. And this was an example of, was kind of like a call to consciousness around one of the musicians that co-wrote the song had witnessed a police killing, a tragic police killing of a Black man, I believe. And that sparked this whole conversation. And we're listening to just that feeling of the song, what's going on? Yeah, what's going on? And inviting ourselves to become aware of that experience of what we call in Buddhism dukkha. Yeah, and seeing that as a crux point, really, where if we deny our feelings, or we try to like move away from uncomfortable feelings, we keep going around this very cyclical conditionality, this cycles of repeating ignorance, more suffering. But traditionally in Buddhism, if we become aware of that tender messiness of being human, just how much more there is to go to create a world of full of safety, dignity, and longing for everyone, a place of connection in times of polarization, connection with each other, across difference, with our earth, our planet, all the living beings that rely on this ecosystem, that are suffering from a lack of attention to caring for the earth. All that, if we turn towards that, turning towards this particular kind of difficult emotion, this kind of tenderness, and come in contact with that, then so much more becomes possible. Yeah, what else is possible? That question that we were asking, what else is possible? So much more becomes possible. So how can we do that? And I was implying that maybe there's some really listening to that longing as a beautiful thing. So actually discovering that actually there may be quite a strong, it may not be as hard as we think. You know, there might be a lot of like, oh, I can't on the surface. How can we support that? Rub the top of the legs. Watch you follow just YouTube video, do the kinds of things that support us to be okay. You know, we need that. But then also maybe we could actually follow that. We can actually live into that longing. You know, we brought back this idea that all that's not love that is so distressing is can be met somehow in love. Yeah, including that which is feels broken in ourselves. So there was a real encouragement to the bodhicitta, that jewel of intention is called the most precious thing. So maybe like rather than it being something I want to get rid of or get over, this kind of feeling of the messiness, you know, what, why might this be considered the most precious thing? It's like us turning towards the world, turning towards ourselves, turning towards being in the world. So that was some ground we covered, and we talked about how you know, we know about ethics, meditation, and wisdom is one of the core teachings in Buddhism, a summary of the Eightfold Path. So we've been talking about working with emotions skillfully as the middle way between suppression and indulgence, Yeah, which is also, you could say, all of mindfulness practice is concerned with helping open up that middle way between suppression and indulgence. So in our behavior and also in our way of being with energy, how can we find that middle way where we're not acting out or acting in harmful ways? And we're also not relying on being numb as our lifelong strategy. Yeah. And then wisdom can arise too, where we're beginning to feel there's a little more sense of, oh, there's things that are happening. They're changing all the time. And how can I be with that change? So again, like in this impermanent changing world, how can I be with that change? In the impermanent changing internal world, how can I be with that change? So we begin to see, oh, this is just how it is. There's change. Yeah. And then I suggested that as we practice for a while, and this responds to something in the chat, so I might weave this in, that we might start with wisdom. So we might not think that's going to take, you know, 5,000 lifetimes to get to wisdom. And I was really encouraging us to have confidence in our practice, that as we're learning that there is wisdom. And I offer that as we're practicing and we learn about the Dharma more, we can maybe start from wisdom. And that is starting from this, the view of how it actually is. So rather than thinking we're going to have to get somewhere else to wisdom, that we could start here with just how it is. How is it? And put out this, in summary, you could say openness. When we really look closely at our experience and come closer and closer, more intimately into the truth of our experience, or what can be experienced, yeah, internally, externally, the whole picture, what we find is openness, unconditional love, like openness that can accommodate any experience. So unconditional love in that sense, completely open. Clarity in that there is wakefulness, there is knowing, there is that brightness in the sense of there's an awareness of sensation, there's awareness of thoughts, as possible emotions. There can be a kind of knowing quality, clarity, and then thirdly, sensitivity. Yeah. Sometimes the sensitivity is also like described as endless effulgence, this aliveness flowing. Yeah. So I was saying that how in some of the Vajrayana traditions that start with wisdom, rather than thinking that we're going to get to equanimity at the end of a long chain of the seven awakening factors, if we're lucky, they start with equanimity as a view, which is interesting, which is to just start with, this is how it is. And one way we could express equanimity is, this is how it is, just as it is, as it is. So rather than starting with the managerial part of ourselves that's going to first come in and tell everything how it needs to be and shape it all up, we start with as it is. And remember that. And I said this on the first day, but so I really appreciate the question, which was like, well, that sounds like starting at equanimity, starting at the end, seemed pretty hard. Like, you know, how do we do that? So that's a great question. How do we do that? I mean, if you look at the traditional Tonglen instructions, the instructions for breathing with the suffering of the world and breathing out, just expressing that longing of well-being for all beings, expressing that compassion, can be imagined as feeling the heavy texture, breathing out this moonlight or other kinds of forms of images for that wish coming out on the out-breath, including ourselves in that. The very first instruction in the traditional text of Tonglen says, flash into the open dimension of being, or flash into openness, flash. And you have like less than a finger snap to do that. So you're not creating it. You're not creating or fabricating openness. It doesn't say spend 20 minutes trying to pretend you're open. It says flash into the open dimension of being, which is, it's already there. So in a way we're taking, in Zen, it says, take the backward step. So we're all up in it. We're all up in it, all in it, getting sucked in. It's saying flashing into openness. So I want to invite us to try this. And this is our DJ. This one's going out to Stiramitra. Who put the question in Padlet. So thank you. I want to invite you to try this. So if you can stand, it might be helpful. Experientially get what we're talking about. And if you're seated, you need to be seated or laying down. You can imagine what we're doing energetically in your body. You'll get a sense of it. All right, so we can imagine there's something happening. Like let's just imagine some form of, we're walking about our day and we hit some form of suffering. I'm gonna ask us to imagine like a level 5 or less on a scale of 1 to 10 in terms of intensity. So I'm not trying to ask you to imagine the most horrific thing you can imagine. Something at level 5 where you feel it, but you're not gonna be overwhelmed with it, yeah? It could also be, it could be something where someone's suffering in some kind of physical way. We're saying how social threat also is like, can be very disturbing. So that could be just as simple as someone disagreeing with you. That could be an agitation, a form of suffering. So we can imagine that happening, whatever it is. And I'm gonna invite you in a moment to just get all up into it. Like imagine what that feels like in your thoughts, and you're just really in your thinking. You're like thinking about what am I going to do about this? And you're just very agitated in that particular way. I think raise your hand if you get a sense of the kind of mood. I mean, when you get sucked into it, you get a sense of getting worked up. Yeah. Okay. That. So we're going to do it just for a bit, and we'll be able to come out of it. So in a moment, I'm going to ask you to enter into it by stepping forward and just like imagine you're entering into that very all up in it. You might even get even closer to it and just imagine you're really like maybe you get all up into it. A lot of thoughts, maybe indulging in story. If you're seated, you can imagine just like falling into it. You might even try exaggerating it by contracting some part of your body. Okay, then we're gonna step back. Step back a little. So even that motion of stepping back a little, you want to repeat that, you can step forward and notice what it's like just to step back a little. Okay, so just even here, like a little more spaciousness available. Okay, so now I'm going to invite us with the situations brewing here. I'm going to invite us to step more into your feeling sense, your feeling consciousness, or to move into that. If you're seated, you can imagine, or lying down, you can imagine falling more open into that feeling sense. So moving into the more feeling sense. Take another step back or open up more. Maybe let the arms be a little wider, get some space under the armpit. I'm just feeling here. Sensation. And then we're gonna move, we're gonna fall open even more or choose openness even more. We're gonna invite you in a moment into this really Like there's as if there was more 360 degree awareness. Yeah. Just like as in the moment, we're going to move again, even more open. It could be a step back even more. So more expansiveness. So when you're ready, just let that happen. What happens when we fall open or remember even more openness where there's this open space of potentiality, like the sky? We can be aware of sensations, we can be aware of what's happening, but there's just more freedom for it all to be self-arising by itself, shifting and by itself dissolving without us having to be all up in it, the energies. Themselves, the body. So just unfolding. Now, this is suggestive. We can come back to being together here. So that's suggestive of opening the perspective, coming into this viewpoint of openness, clarity, and sensitivity. So I'm going to invite us to try it just here, like in a finger snap, flash into the open dimension of being, see what happens, okay? So we're just here and Viveka is saying, blah, 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 blah. I'm going to count to three on three, just imagine, let your body somatically imagine flashing open. Yeah. Okay. So first just check, am I safe? Am I okay right now before we try this? Yeah, you might rub the legs for a moment. Just check. You're in choice about what you do. All right. Right. So 1, 2, 3, just flashing open. Actually doing less right now. We're doing less. Okay, you can't maintain it. You can't try to force it. It's already there. We remember. Okay, I can have a little shake. Ooh, in case we're trying to do anything. All right, we're gonna give it one more try. Count of three. Flashing open. To the open dimension of being. 1, 2, 3. The eyes get more panoramic. Maybe you feel the back of the body more. Often forgotten. Okay, so does anyone want to put in chat how you did that? How did you do that? I love these. I just dropped trying to do anything. Hallelujah. I want to swear for some reason. Holla effing Luya. I just dropped trying to do anything. I didn't know what to do. So I think I stopped doing anything. Went to the edge of my body and beyond. Let it go with a deep out breath and opening of the chest area. Opening all my pores, nice. portals, the portals of the pores, all breathing, opening. I fell backwards gently. Yeah, with the Tibetan yogic exercise. I'm not sure I'm recommending this. I'm just sharing it with you. Where, you know, we did this thing where you try, you're hold, just holding space. And after a while, if you're standing, it gets quite hard to maintain. At some point you do just fall down. So it's just like in that moment of falling, it's an example of falling open. Yeah, I can't hold it anymore. I can't hold it anymore. It's like Scotty on the Starship Enterprise. I need Pat to do it for me. I can't hold it anymore, Captain. Yeah. I took the in-breath of delight. Falling back gently made me laugh. Just dropped into letting go of everything. Had a Vajrasattva shower. Imagine I'm split open and a waterfall of white energy flows through me. Felt free to be landing in the full experience of my body. Yeah. So some of, in the, we talked about how if we start with a wisdom perspective, meditation is getting used to it. Yeah. The meditation is a meditation of getting used to this openness, clarity, and sensitivity. And in that, allowing things to fall open, maybe even fall apart, within a wisdom perspective, which is very different than having a nervous breakdown. Yeah. It's within a perspective of a loving falling open. Yeah. And there may be some tightness around that, but even like, even when we support one joint and it maybe begins to soften, just there as an example, we can take a huge cue from something like that. Yeah. So sometimes we imagine it has to be very dramatic, but just, we did the thing where you hold a joint. We could try that now. Just hold that wrist, support it. And just this is it. Just this is it. It's holding of the wrist. Yeah, the space of awareness and all that's happening. Felt free to be landing in the full experience of my body. Walk forward into raw, albeit comfortable trembles, raw and comfortable. So poetically it's said we're coming home when we flash open into the, as it is, it's like coming home. Yeah. Yeah. So from that place, like in that place of being, from dukkha into shraddha into faith, like just that we can be here with it as it is, and then from there find compassionate action. Yeah, where we're not actually trying to push anything away or for or dominate. We're not, so deep healing of some of the ills of our society. We're not trying to dominate. So it's so huge being able to feel discomfort and practice with it. Yeah. Because it's from not being able to tolerate it that we get intolerance in our world. Yeah.
I feel like I have to apologize for turning John Coltrane off. We hadn't talked about how long the music was going to go for. And then when I realized the track was 8 minutes long, I was like, oh, Lordy. But we'll come back to it, I promise. Yeah, thank you. I've been, sorry, I just need to put myself in gallery view. I can't stand talking to an image of myself. That's just weird. There you all are. Hello. friendly waves. I just want to name that I'm feeling so much gratitude right now for you, Viveka, and just that everything you're saying is just like vibrating at a very deep level for me. And it's almost like all of the times that I've sat with you and you've said similar things, that It's like all that's here as well. It's like all in me and part of me. And yeah, I'm just so grateful to you, my dear friend and teacher. So yeah, we're going to do this Padmasambhava ritual. So I'm going to say a few things and then we'll have a brief leg stretch because we'll have been sitting for quite a long time by then. And then I've got these four verses written by Vasantra that I really love. I think they're very powerful. And we've got some readings and we've got thank you to the volunteers who are going to be the voice of the retreat. So we've got one volunteer for each verse and we'll go through the running order when we get to that point. And I'll say more about how the ritual is going to run. So Padmasambhava, the great guru, 8th century, traveled from India to Tibet and largely credited, although he wasn't alone in this endeavor with bringing Buddhism to Tibet. And one of the things that I really am so moved by when I think about Padmasambhava is the fact that he crossed the Himalayas in the 8th century, which must have been really hard going. I mean, they didn't have Gore-Tex back then, did they? So yeah, that always really almost moves me to tears when I think about like how much the motivation to share the Dharma with other beings was, that it moved him to literally cross mountains. So I wanted to say a little bit about some of the symbolism. So, and I do have a tanka of Padmasambhava, which I might show you in a minute. But one of the things is that he's wearing these three robes. They're very rich, deep colors. So the outer robe is a deep red color of compassion and also associated with the Mahayana. So representing sort of the whole path of ethics and action and how we show up in the world and the Bodhisattva ideal of being of service and of benefit to all beings. And then he's got the middle robe, which is yellow, like the monk's robe. So this is more like the path of meditation, of discipline, of structure, of, having a sense of who we are and where we're going in our practice and sort of, you could even say like representing the developmental model, working with conditioning, how we meet our karmic inheritance and the effort that we apply to turn towards it, transform it. And then the inner robe, which is the blue, deep blue, robe of the, it's hidden, you can't really see it, maybe little flashes of it every now and then, which is the Vajrayana, and it's this closest to the heart, right up against the skin, representing our true nature, this open sky, this vast open endless sky that we were just feeling into with those beautiful exercises that Viveka led us in. And when we were talking about it in the team, Viveka also reminded me of this very well-loved quote within our movement. So Padmasambhava saying, his view is as wide as the sky and his conduct as fine as grains of, I think it's barley, some kind of very fine grain. So actually, Viveka, would you mind dropping that chat, that quote in the chat? So yeah, so we've got, even in the imagery of Padmasambhava, we've got this invitation to sand. Oh yeah, as fine as grains of sand. Oh yeah, maybe it is grains of sand. Anyways, something fine as opposed to something large and vast. So so it's sort of like I think I said this at some point in one of the morning sessions, where one of the things that we're doing in our practice is learning to more and more trust deeply in our true nature. Trust deeply in this awareness that receives the whole of our lives unbiasedly, totally, fully, clearly, as it is, just this, while also deeply honoring and having a deep respect for our conditioning, this body, this nervous system, how we might be showing up in the moment, which can sometimes feel very far from our ideals. So we've got both, and in the robes, it sort of represents the fullness of that. So everything from the ideal, how we'd like to be in the world, full of love and compassion, you know, the warm red robe that envelops all beings. And then this kind of the discipline of the mendicant and working hard in our practice and whatever else we do, the efforts we apply. And then this, the inner robe, like nothing to be done. We're already awake. We already are. We've already arrived. And I'll just say this because it keeps coming up. It wants to be said. It's with me. And I think often when I think about Padmasambhava, I think about, there's two people that come to mind. Viveka, who gave me the practice. So Padmasambhava is my yidam, which is a Buddha or Bodhisattva that we meditate on. And it's given to us at the time of our ordination. So I think about Viveka, who have lovely memories of us in the very temporary sadhana hut up at Akashavana. I think it only lasted a couple of years before it got blown down in a storm. Doing this practice together and learning it from her. And then I also think of Bhante, who also had a very, very strong connection with Sangharakshita. And one of the things that I remember him saying to me in one of the times that I met with him directly after my ordination, I went to see him and I asked him about transforming anger. And I was a bit full of myself, having just gotten ordained. I was a bit intoxicated with myself. Anyway, so I said, I kind of went in sort of wanting the higher teachings. I said, oh, Sangharakshita, you know, I've been working for years and years on anger. You know, anger is my go-to klesha. You know, please tell me how I can transform my anger into energy in pursuit of the good. And he said, oh, well, you know, you just bring awareness to it. And then arrogant 33-year-old me was like, yeah, and then what do you do? I was like, yeah, I know. You bring awareness to it. I got that. I got that down. And then what do you do? And he's like, you just bring awareness to it. And I was so humbled. I was like, oh, yeah, of course. Can I trust that awareness is enough? Can I really trust that awareness is enough? Like, I really don't need anything else than this awareness that I already have right now, right here. Everything I have is right here. And when I say that, I mean, like, you know, a warm, loving, open, curious awareness. Yeah. Okay, so a little bit more about Padmasambhava. I'll just mention the cremation ground, because this is a place that we often find Padmasambhava. So cremation ground, otherwise known. So that would be like the Indian version of the graveyard, the cemetery. Yeah, so we're the last stop on the journey of life. And this is often the cremation ground is used as a metaphor for what Bhante calls the crucial situation. So when we're sort of right up against ourselves, when we feel like we've exhausted all of our strategies for how to manage life. Like the egoic mind has nothing left. It's like the tank is empty and we don't know what else to do. And that's like the moment where, like in Padmasambhava's world, this is like the most, like it's the most exciting moment, because it means that like, transformation, like the potential for transformation is greatest in these moments where we're right up against ourselves, if we can recognize them and use them in this way. So sort of like relate to them, maybe is a better way of putting it, relate to them and engage with them from this place of curiosity, turning towards courage that Viveka mentioned today, big emphasis on courage. So Padmasambhava is also sometimes related to as the alchemist, the magician. I've got my magician's wand here. and he works to transform the raw material of our conditioning, including the kleshas that drive us to act unskillfully, into the awakening factors and all the good things, the forces for good, the first forces for love, all that wonderful stuff that we want so much, that our heart deeply longs for. So he transforms the raw material of our lives like an alchemist transforming. What do alchemists transform? Is it coal into gold? Something. Transform something raw into gold. Yeah. Okay, so raw metals. Thanks, books. So let's have a little leg stretch, just like a couple minutes. Stand up, shake the legs, do a little bounce. If you need to go to the loo, now would be a good time. And while we're waiting for people to, I notice a lot of empty squares there. So I may as well take this opportunity to show you the chanka, the Padmasambhava that I'm sitting under. It's very golden and shimmery, very shimmery. He's got these wonderful, see if I can zoom in here, colorful, sort of rainbow-like things, beautiful flowers, very nice eyes, seductive. And I love the detail. There's like little, his fingernails have like, see if I can get the fingernails here. Pink in them. Yeah, and that's Padmasambhava. Actually, I'll just share one more thing, which is that Viveka said to me, which always comes back during these rituals, she encouraged me. So I was very much on the insight, wisdom end of things, when it's sort of striving for. For truth, very much on the hard edge of that. Said, maybe you could just open to Padmasambhava's warm compassion. I was like, floods of tears. So yeah, he can crack you open. So watch out, beware. Okay, so the running order of things. So we shall start with just a pause, and then we'll do the first verse, which is called Requesting the Guru for Attainments, and Parveen will be the voice of the retreat for that section. Parveen, where are you? So maybe you could wave if you've got your camera off. Ah, there you are. Okay, just want to check that you're here. Didn't lose you. And then we've got... at the end of that verse, we'll have a reading from Jayashrada. Thank you, Jayashrada. And that's from Self-Liberation Through Seeing with Naked Awareness. And it's already on the Padlet. It's the reading I shared this morning. And then we'll hear the second verse, requesting the guru to activate the mantra. And Rachel will be the voice of the retreat for that verse. And then we'll have... one version from Mahasukha of the Padmasambhava mantra. And feel free to make offerings at your at-home shrines during that mantra. And then we'll have the third verse, requesting the guru to remove obstacles to the bodhisattva path, and mumukshu will be the voice of the retreat for that verse. And then what we're going to do is we're going to have a chance to just individually reflect. And I'll put John Coltrane back on for this. And these reflections are a chance to just turn towards any habits of your own that you've noticed on this retreat, any parts of you that have come up that maybe you have had a tendency to relate to, like, I want this to go away. I don't want to be feeling this. I don't want this habit anymore. So something that you're sort of wanting, maybe have had a kind of attitude towards that's more like, no, and just see what it might be like on this retreat. The invitation is to sort of turn towards and get curious about and start relating to that, with the tending and the mindfulness, of course. So if there's something like that, to just name it for ourselves, and maybe in the light of Padmasambhava's great compassion and asking for his support to really lean in much closer to these parts of us, and just see if we can listen for their integrity and what they might be needing, particularly from the tending point of view, like how might we tend to them so that they can be fully transformed in the light of Padmasambhava's awareness and compassion. So it's an opportunity to sort of flip the script on, like, I just want to get rid of this thing. I want to let it go, you know, that kind of like can be quite pat, like, oh, I just need to let go of my anger. It's like, how the hell do you do that? Maybe one way is getting curious about what's actually going on there. What's the underlying need? Yeah. So we're going to ask Padmasambhava to help us with that. And then we'll have the last verse, requesting the guru to free us from ignorance, and Fran will be the voice of the retreat for that verse. And we'll end with another version of the Padmasambhava mantra. And during that last mantra, there's an invitation to drop your offerings, these parts of us that we want to offer to Padmasambhava for his help, asking for his help in working more creatively with them. So we'll be offering those, and you can drop those into the chat during that last mantra. Okay, so clear as mud. Yes, thank you, Daiketu. So if you're a volunteer who's going to be the voice of the retreat or do a reading, and you're not okay with being spotlighted, so let's do an opt out. If you'd rather not be spotlighted, if you could private message Daiketu and he'll keep you off the spotlight. Otherwise, we'll spotlight you if that's okay. All right. One more thing just to mention, there is mention of dakinis in these verses. So for those of you who might not know, a dakini is a fully enlightened, there's dakas as well and dakins. So there's female, male, and non-binary figures like of this ilk, and they hang out with Padmasambhava on the cremation ground, and they just represent sort of uninhibited, compassionate energy in the world. And they're also associated with the Sangha refuge. So they're very much about beloved community. They make up Padmasambhava's beloved community, and they have a very mutual relationship with him. So they teach him the Dharma as much as he teaches them the Dharma. So that's what's happening there when we come across that language. All right, I'm aware of time, so let's get the show on the road. So we'll just sit for a moment and then we'll begin. Request to Guru Padmasambhava. requesting the guru for attainments. Precious guru.
Precious guru.
Vajra Lord.
Vajra Lord.
Just as you refused to bow down.
Just as you refused to bow down.
To the King of Tibet.
To the King of Tibet.
So may I never bow down.
So may I never bow down.
To the powers of mundane life.
To the powers of mundane life.
Just as you proclaimed.
Just as you proclaimed.
Your Dharma lineage.
Your Dharma lineage.
So may I proclaim myself.
So may I proclaim myself.
A descendant of the Buddhas.
A descendant of the Buddhas.
Precious Guru.
Precious Guru.
Vajra Lord.
Vajra Lord.
Just as you lived fearless.
Just as you lived fearless.
In the cremation ground.
In the cremation ground.
You're back to the stupa.
You're back to the stupa.
Feasting with the Dakinis.
Feasting with the Dakinis.
So may I live fearless.
So may I live fearless.
Facing life and death.
Facing life and death.
Supported by the Dharma.
Supported by the Dharma.
Offering sustenance to all beings.
Offering sustenance to all beings.
Precious Guru.
Precious Guru.
Vajra Lord.
Vajra Lord.
Just as you manifested.
Just as you manifested.
Eight great forms.
Eight great forms.
Peaceful and wrathful.
Peaceful and wrathful.
From the magic of the mind.
And then from the magic of the mind.
So may I manifest.
So may I manifest.
Endless ways of being.
Endless ways of being.
Loving and tender.
Loving and tender.
Helpful and supportive.
Helpful and supportive.
Courageous and energetic.
Courageous and energetic.
Wise and decisive.
Wise and decisive.
To guide all I meet.
To guide all I meet.
To your state of freedom.
To your state of freedom.
Now, when you are introduced to your own intrinsic awareness, the method for entering into it involves three considerations. Thoughts in the past are clear and empty and leave no trace behind. Thoughts in the future are fresh and unconditioned by anything. And in the present moment, when your mind remains in its own condition without constructing anything, awareness at that moment in itself is quite ordinary. And when you look into yourself in this way nakedly, without any discursive thoughts, since there's only this pure observing, there will be found a lucid clarity without anyone being there who is the observer. Only a naked, manifest awareness is present. This awareness is empty and immaculately pure, not being created by anything whatsoever. It is authentic and unadulterated, without any duality of clarity and emptiness. It is not permanent, and yet it is not created by anything. However, it is not a mere nothingness or something annihilated, because it is lucid and present. It does not exist as a single entity, because it is present and clear in terms of being many. On the other hand, it is not created as a multiplicity of things, because it is inseparable and of a single flavor. This inherent self-awareness does not derive from anything outside itself. This is the real introduction to the actual condition of things.
Requesting the guru to activate the mantra. Precious guru, Vajra Lord.
Precious guru, Vajra Lord.
With Om, Ah, and Hum.
With Om, Ah, and Hum.
May my body, speech, and mind.
May my body, speech, and mind.
Become one with the Dharma.
Become one with the Dharma.
With Vajra may I become.
With Vajra may I become.
A champion of the truth.
A champion of the truth.
A fearless warrior without weapons.
A fearless warrior without weapons.
Taking the offensive.
Taking the offensive.
Against the forces of darkness.
Against the forces of darkness.
Hatred.
Hatred.
And cruelty.
And cruelty.
With Guru may I become.
With Guru may I become.
A sovereign of the mandala.
A sovereign of the mandala.
Bringing harmony, stability, and blessing.
Bringing harmony, stability, and blessing.
To the world.
To the world.
With Padma, may the lotus of my heart.
With Padma, may the lotus of my heart.
Open completely.
Open completely.
Radiating love to all that lives.
Radiating love to all that lives.
With city, may I experience.
With city, may I experience.
The magical power of the mind.
The magical power of the mind.
And may I wield that power.
And may I wield that power.
To create a pure land.
To create a pure land.
With Hum.
With Hum.
May these four aspects.
May these four aspects.
Form a harmonious mandala.
Form a harmonious mandala.
Stable as the double Vajra.
Stable as the double Vajra.
Light o' day, light I do, light o' day, light I o, light o' day, light I da, light o' day. Oh,
Requesting the guru to remove obstacles to the bodhisattva path. Lotus King.
Lotus King.
Born from Amitabha's heart.
Born from Amitabha's heart.
This world.
Appearing in this world.
Out of great love and great compassion.
Out of great love and great compassion.
By all the truth of the Dharma.
By all the truth of the Dharma.
By all the power of enlightenment.
By all the power of enlightenment.
I solemnly request.
I solemnly request.
May you hear and now.
May you hear and now.
Remove all obstacles.
Remove all obstacles.
To the bodhicitta.
To the bodhicitta.
Arising in my heart.
Arising in my heart.
May you relax the tightness.
May you relax the tightness.
That holds me back from giving.
That holds me back from giving.
May you defeat the recklessness.
May you defeat the recklessness.
Of ignoring that actions have consequences.
Of ignoring that actions have consequences.
May you quieten the restlessness.
May you quieten the restlessness.
That makes me impatient with present experience.
That makes me impatient with present experience.
May you overcome the laziness and fear.
May you overcome the laziness and fear.
That prevent me making effort on the path.
that prevent me making effort on the path.
May you dissolve the habitual tendencies.
May you dissolve the habitual tendencies.
That keep my mind circling.
That keep my mind circling.
Never settling to meditation.
Never settling to meditation.
May you eradicate the ignorance.
May you eradicate the ignorance.
Of turning a blind eye to experience.
Of turning a blind eye to experience.
That stops me discovering blissful wisdom.
That stops me discovering blissful wisdom.
May I fulfill the six perfections.
May I fulfill the six perfections.
Just have a quiet space for a few minutes to reflect, and I'll put the prompt in the chat. So individual reflections on what we want to allow to self-liberate by turning towards recognizing the need and asking for support in meeting it. Requesting the Guru to free us from ignorance. Precious Guru.
Precious Guru.
Unsurpassed magician.
Unsurpassed magician.
Of the sublime Dharma.
Of the sublime Dharma.
Break the spell.
Break the spell.
That forces me.
That forces me.
To wander lost.
To wander lost.
In the enchanted forest of samsara.
In the enchanted forest of samsara.
Break the spell.
Break the spell.
That compels me.
That compels me.
To see boundaries and barriers.
To see boundaries and barriers.
In the limitless space of mind.
In the limitless space of mind.
Break the spell.
Break the spell.
That drives me.
That drives me.
To grasp at the empty mirage.
To grasp at the empty mirage.
Of the mind's display.
Of the mind's display.
Break the spell.
Break the spell.
That binds me.
That binds me.
To endless suffering.
To endless suffering.
When my mind is by nature.
When my mind is by nature.
Blissful.
Blissful.
Om Aum Vajra Guru Padma Siddhi Om Aum Vajra Guru Padma Siddhi Om Aum Vajra Guru Padma Siddhi Om Aum Vajra Guru. Padmasiddhi Ho.
Thank you for your practice. Do feel free to keep dropping offerings into the chat. And I'll also create a space on Padlet for those as well. So, well, feel free to make any reactions or say anything by way of goodbye, and we'll see you in 13 hours. Actually, 12 hours and 55 minutes.
Thank you, Singhashri. Thank you.
You're welcome. Go well.